I'm Robin, and I'm here. I'll let everybody sort of introduce themselves and say who they are and why they're part of the panel.
Is that a new painting, Robin?
That is not. It was a gift.
You checking what it was?
My old boss's dad made it, painted it for me before he passed away. So I keep it up all the time.
I like it.
You too. So intros, who you are, why you're part of the panel, and what you do. You want to start, Rich, or?
Sure. My name is Rich Myrick. I'm a producer at Nacelle Company. I'm into toys like Brian. I tend to have my hands in pretty much everything going on at the company. So I guess that's why I'm on this panel too. And I'm happy to be here.
Who wants to be next? David?
Ladies first.
All right, ladies first.
I'll go. Sure, why not? Hey everyone, I am Bevan. I work with Den of Geek, and I also work with Electric Entertainment. Brian and I are old buddies. We featured him a lot in Den of Geek, and we brought him on to our Star Wars podcast, and Brian was kind enough to bring me on to the BET Plus show All the Way Black, and that is why I am here. Thank you guys so much for having me.
Nice having
you. Cool. My name is David Varner, and I'm a toy designer. I've worked with multiple companies, but mainly known for Marvel. But I've worked for Marvel, Hasbro, Mattel, on all the major brands. And I love pop culture and love talking pop culture, so I guess that's why I'm here too.
Woo!
And Brian.
Robin, ladies first.
Oh, I did mine at the top. I'm Robin. Work sometimes with Nacelle on some of their projects, and did a couple projects that they did in the past year, and I think that's why I'm here.
I'm Brian. I founded Nacelle, and I too like pop culture, but I would say I like toys like Rich.
Yes, you do. So SDCC, doing it remote, doing it virtual. What does that mean?
Last year.
Huh?
A little different than last year.
Yeah, a little different than last year.
I think for me, the thing that I'm going to miss the most about not physically being down in San Diego is just like, there are, like, I call them like Comic-Con moments. There are like things that happen that you didn't plan to happen, like interactions, people you meet. Like last year, Dave, our buddy Sean, we were just walking the floor and I just randomly met Bootsy Collins, and it was like one of the highlights of the weekend. And it's just like that kind of like spontaneous stuff that only happens at Comic-Con is what I think I'll miss the most personally. I don't know about you guys.
Yeah, those spontaneous interactions and everything. And also like I love people and I love to talk. So, mm-hmm. You know, Comic-Con is always a good time to, you know, see your friends, you know, that it's like your family, you know, and I always say that at conventions, you know, we all could be best friends. So it's like seeing your really good best friend or your cousin or your relative that you haven't seen in a while. You're all getting together, you're all talking, and everyone's on the same level. Like, you know, for those 5 days, like, you know, you can have a guy there that is like for 360 days, he's nothing. But for those 5 days, you know, he could dress up in a banana suit and expect it wherever he is, you know, to wear that banana suit. And it's perfectly cool, you know? So, and everyone's just on the same mindset, the same wavelength, and the vibe is just so, so cool, you know? It's like Woodstock every year. Every year is like that. And I even miss the holy rollers, like the Bible thumpers is out there with the, you know, the signs out there. You're going to hell. Yes. You know, in light speed. You know, so like I kind of miss them too. It's all part of this, just the spectacle of it, you know, and that's what I miss, the spectacle.
Yeah, I really miss the community of it. Like when I go with Den of Geek, like San Diego Comic-Con for me is a whole week because we're doing a lot of prep. We're meeting with people ahead of time because a lot of talent can't come in and get interviewed like during those 5 days, but they'll come in like before or after. And I love the community of it. I love the aspect of going out and just meet. Everyone has that same heightened level of energy. And I almost feel like it's the happiest place on earth. And Disney has nothing on San Diego Comic-Con crowds. They have nothing because there's just this joy that everybody has. And you can make random friends with people. And it's great.
Lifelong.
How I met Brian. Yeah. Brian and I met at San Diego Comic-Con.
Mm-hmm.
I missed the Q&A with the fans at the end of the panels. I really, like, it's those questions, which, as you guys know, I mean, range from the very, very, very specific to just, you know, just hearing their point of view on stuff we've done. That's without a doubt the thing I miss the most. And the reaction to people seeing our trailers of what, like, we announced movies that made us last year. Nobody even knew it was being made.
Right.
And we showed it. So the lights went down. We had already shown the trailer for season 3 of Toys. And then about 20 minutes later, we were like, hey, we got something else for you. The lights went down. And the way the trailer worked, it said Toys That Made Us, and then the word toys started flipping and became movies. There was a beat where nobody reacted. And I mean, I would say it was one of the greatest moments of my life, not connected to my family, hearing.
That feeling, that look that you see on the fans' face and that feeling that they convey, like when they see something for the first time, it's like seeing a magic trick, you know, for the first time. And that's what I love about designing toys. Like when I'm in the aisle, you know, and I see a kid just light up, or a guy that's like middle-aged just light up, you know, or even like a mom who finds that toy, you know, that was hard to find, and her face just lights up. Like, that look is priceless because it's not an act. It's totally real.
Joy.
Yep.
What about your Comic-Con strategies?
See, this is one that
I know some of you well enough to know that for this year, I guess now that it's virtual, you won't have your Comic-Con strategy, right? There's a whole
very curious.
Month-long plan on how to do Comic-Con, right?
Oh yeah.
I usually get on the average about 4.5 hours of sleep a night during Comic-Con week.
What?
And I don't do it at all until I get home. Oh, it's insane.
God. Rest so well.
I just, it's like a level of zen that I reach where I don't need like the normal human amount of rest because I'm just so fueled by everything that's going on and this need to try and do as much of it as possible. So, I mean, this will be my first year in I think 13 years that I won't be down at Comic-Con, which I'm sure is probably not uncommon for a lot of people, but like, it's weird. It's weird because I also like plot my, you know, time throughout the year based on what conventions are happening. So not having any happening is kind of thrown off my internal calendar. But yeah, my Comic-Con strategy has been honed for years, and like knowing what you have to like wait, like your, like how much you want to do certain things and kind of figure out like your backup plans and then have enough fluidity in your schedule too. So when things that pop up that you didn't even know were happening pop up, you can find a way to like, you know, make that work without blowing up your whole schedule. It's a whole convoluted thing. You know, it's like a flow chart, but it works. It works great.
My strategy is very simple. Get to the floor. Number one, where is Ego Moss? Go to Ego Moss.
Number two,
that entire shelf is Eagle Moss.
Eagle Moss.
Number two, Diamond Select. Then, as Bevan has seen twice, even though she may think she's only seen it once, calculate how much power does my spinal column have and try and see as much before it goes out. Bevan was aware once, I could barely walk, But actually, the first time we met, I was all, I don't know if you could even, I was literally sweating so hard. I was in so much pain by that time we met the first time. But that is the end of my strategy.
I thought your strategy was to walk the aisles, Brian. I've been with you where you have a very specific.
We've never done that at Comic-Con together. We've only done it other places. And you can't do that at Comic-Con for two reasons. One is because of all the stuff we do for the shows, my back is already getting f***ed up. Can I curse, Rich? Yeah.
You already did.
So, well, we could edit it. A, and then B, it's too crowded. Like, you can't, like, what we did at Wizard or wherever we were, like, where was the one we were at?
I thought we were at Comic-Con. No, we were at the one here in LA Comic-Con.
Yeah, like those aisles, you can't do that at Comic-Con, which is not a big fan of crowds. You can't do that. So I go to Eagle Moss, I go to Diamond Select, and then I do the best I can.
So with everything being virtual now, how are you guys keeping yourselves pop culture fluent without your normal, is it all virtual?
Yeah, I mean, I can speak, like, Den of Geek right now is doing everything all virtual. I don't know, we haven't really decided if we're going to be involved with San Diego Comic-Con virtually because there's just not a lot of shows that have signed up. And like DC made an announcement that they're gonna do their own virtual event thing. So we haven't really decided, but I mean, a lot of what's been happening with Den of Geek and myself is just we've been doing virtual interviews. I've been bringing on a lot of people for the Star Wars podcast for Electric Now app. So I've been doing a lot of virtual Zoom just like this, like multiple people. We're talking about Star Wars with different guests and stuff like that. And then Den of Geek, we did a couple of like interviews that go on our social platform right now.
What about the rest of you? What about you, Rich? If you say you don't have your internal time clock.
Yeah.
It's been a little different. I mean, Brian and I have done, what is this, our third one that we've done so far? Virtual panel, I think. And then done a couple other ones. So it's been an interesting adjustment. But one of the things that I do like about Comic-Con going virtual, if I had to pick any sort of silver lining, is the fact that it does add an air of accessibility to San Diego Comic-Con that wouldn't otherwise be there. So people are able to see all of these panels virtually. And if I'm not mistaken, I think there is a greater air of accessibility for like the exclusives and stuff too, for people who, you know, oftentimes can't get the exclusive things they want. So and I think San Diego is even allowing everyone to be able to print out their own San Diego 2020 Comic-Con badge. You know, everyone gets a badge, everyone gets to go. So that's cool, cute. Kind of like silver lining for this, that everyone gets to go to Comic-Con for once, which is pretty cool. So that's cool. A good way to look at it.
So that's under quarantine, when you can't, well, I guess now you may be able to go to a toy store. I think they're just now starting to open and you can't go to conventions. What do you guys do to stay pop culture fluent?
Dave?
You know, it's funny. I kind of do see on the designing end. This whole transition is very almost it's very normal because like this panel that we're having, it's almost like we have like weekly VCs, video chats with our Asian partners, right? So we're always, you know, talk about issues and problems and showing them product and everything. So on that end, it's almost like the world is actually experiencing what we experience all the time. Mm-hmm. So being on this end, you know, we're always like, you know, surfing the web and everything and going on YouTube. Like that's part of our research, you know? So now that everyone is actually in this format, like this is something that personally I've been pushing for years for us to do. Like it's between the Comic-Cons and everything, how do we push new product or new ideas to the fans? Like NECA kind of has been doing this for a long time where they've been engaging with the fans. fans virtually and everything. But now it's like, now virtual is becoming the new buzzword. That's the new word, like innovation in toys. So now that we're doing this, it's like, it's, for me, it's like, I feel like I'm at work or everyone is experiencing what I have always experienced, you know? So it's almost like everyone has to be patient now. You kind of have a captivated audience. So you really have them at their whim. You can really do what you want to do, you know, show how you really want to, you know, present the product and everything like that. So it's on that end is very almost normal to me. And it's fun in a way to kind of see the world revolve around what we've kind of been used to all this time and what we've been pushing for.
Hey, I got questions as it relates to quarantine, and as the guy, probably the best abs in all of pop culture, have you been doing more crunchies or less crunchies during quarantine? are you friends with David on social media, Robin?
I am.
It's like the 89 Batman chest was like sculpted off of his. In fact, if anything, Bonner's looks more fake than Keaton's.
Well, I will say that Dave inspired me to get a pull-up bar in my bedroom.
I saw it a month ago and I'm still in shock.
Yeah, on that end, you know, I've been using this time to, like, you know, I've always, you know, done calisthenics and everything like that. Like, I never lift weights. I don't use any weights. So I always do pull-ups and push-ups. I run a lot, jog around the neighborhood. So, you know, I've always done that. But this has enabled me to, you know, not only be in touch with my more physical side, but my mental space too, you know, like this has been wonders for me to, you know, for me to just understand myself better, kind of get into my zen a little bit and understand more of the philosophical side. You know, my wife and I have connected more, you know, so it's we've been having more creative conversations about, you know, this and other things. So, you know, it's really been, I've looked at this whole quarantine situation as a method to better whatever I had going on. You know, whatever has stopped for the moment, it stopped for a reason. I can't do anything about it. So what can I do in the meantime to fix myself? So, you know, that's really what it's been, and it's fun. It's fun to work out, run around, and then the results. You know, you get a nice little body, little abs, little chest, and all that stuff.
At
47, you know, it's you gotta. I work out for the old me, you know. So, you know, even though I'm doing it presently, it's for the older me when I don't want to do that anymore.
If I were you, and I'm not even kidding, I would literally jog or whatever you do with a 2x4 and constantly try and get people to smash me in the stomach with it. if I could break it. I'm not even kidding.
Well, brothers can't be running around with 2x4s in their hands because it looks a little different. You don't want to run. We got enough issues as it is, brother. We got to take one step at a time.
Yeah, that was a bad idea. Maybe just in the
point, you said how what you've been doing is kind of similar to what everyone's doing. I kind of feel like that's kind of one of the interesting side effects of all this is that it has sort of like brought everyone to the same level. Like there's kind of been this whole like between audience and content creators where like there's this side of it and this side of it. And now even in like the entertainment we're watching, everything is kind of right here. So again, it kind of adds an air of like relatability between like the audience and content creators, which is pretty cool.
And content creation changed like in a snap. It seemed like adapted fairly quickly. I think, right? Wouldn't you say so?
Absolutely. I mean, they did, right, Brian?
Yeah. No. So I just saw something that came out where I was like, well, I mean, Netflix, I mean, the thing I'll never forget to the day I die was Netflix was like, hey, you know, we put this Tiger thing out a week ago. We now have an 8th episode. It's like, well, when did you shoot that? Yeah. And I don't know if you saw it or not, but
I did.
they got Joel McHale in his weird ass room where I'm not sure what he did with his camera. It's like he glued it to the ceiling. It was really weird. But then they got everybody from the cast all over the world and they had an episode up. That was when I was like, wow, like, this isn't going to slow anybody down.
Right. No. But what do you think the long and short term effects of that is going to be? I mean, now that people see this is a way to shoot, or you can shoot from home, or do you think some of this will last?
Yeah. I mean, we've built now 8 remote shooting kits. This week we have one in Australia, one in England, and the other 6 are spread out throughout the United States. We're not going to throw them in the dumpster when this is over. So what I think will happen is, like, you know how, like, we'll be like in Orlando shooting something, Robin, and like we can't get to that and we can't get to that. I bet in the future we'll go to Orlando and do what we're doing.
Yeah.
But before we get there, we'll mail those kits ahead of us. That'll get shot before we get there, delivered to our hotel, and then we bring them back with us.
Wow,
so if our crew could have only gotten 10 interviews, by the time we fly back, we'll have 12 or 13. That's a guess.
That's interesting. That
what's in the kit?
Yeah.
It's 2 cameras, an audio recording device, a lighting kit, and 2 hard drives.
Nice.
Wow.
And we've been using them now for over 2 months for all of our Netflix shows and this History Channel thing we're doing. Only one of our shows will not let us use them, right, Robin? That took you a minute. They work. I mean, they work. You'd never be able to tell we didn't have a 5 to 10 person crew.
Oh, cool. You know, to me, the cool thing about this new content generation is the discovery of it. You know, it's like finding this new content in various ways and various formats. Mm-hmm. It's like it's almost like the 70s all over again when you flip in the channel, you know, and you're seeing like the local stuff, like those local channels,
yes.
those local creators,
yes. Yes.
The interesting content. It's like that all over again.
Yes.
And that sparked a whole generation and a revolution of filmmakers and content. So this whole situation has sparked so much new way of thinking. And because we were all in the same boat, we had to take it in. Like, everyone has to take it in. So now it's like, now we have all this technology and these new ways of creating the content and everything. Like, what are we going to do with it? And now with that is what's going to come out of that. And that's what's going to be the interesting part.
Were you already prepared, Brian? Was Nacelle already prepared? Had you been something that you had thought about prior to this? Was it something that... Well, I mean, you're on the innovative. I mean, you've always been on the innovative tip. I mean, was it something that you knew, you know, like, this could, you know, we could shoot interviews remotely. This is something we could do anyway.
I think you're being very kind, especially as someone who's worked with me many times. I would not say we're innovative. I would say we react creatively when we have to, after the fact. I would not say planning ahead of time, unless I'm forced to, is my where I start out. But we evacuated very quickly. And, you know, we started shooting a show, a toy store near you. I suddenly realized, Rich, what you were trying to get me to do 5 minutes later. Thank you. So we shot a show from scratch and released it all in 58 days. And never in a million years did I think we could do that until we quasi had to do it. But to be completely honest with you, and I'm not just trying to say stuff to kiss Netflix's ass, you know, a week after we started evacuating, Netflix called and was like, hey, just keep working. And them saying that, that's what gave me the confidence to build those kits. If Netflix hadn't done that, I wouldn't have built the kits. So, because I would have had kids sitting around doing nothing. Wow. So, so that it took them with staggering amounts of risk to be allowing us to shoot during this, for me to be like, well, let's go.
Wow. Necessity is the mother of invention.
Yeah.
Yes, for sure. For sure. And since you mentioned a toy store near you, do you guys want to talk? Oh, I know, Rich, you want to do the trailer, right, first?
Let's watch the trailer.
I just love that Rich was like, a show we made? And I'm like, oh, Tiger King. Let me talk about Tiger King.
Tiger King, yeah, that's the one I was talking about, yeah.
Well, we tried to lead you there with being innovative, Brian. Brian, you're innovative. Did you know this was going to happen? You got there.
You should talk about 89 Redstone, but that's another story.
Yes.
Okay.
By the way, Bonner, one day when we're in the same room and maybe nobody else is around, I'm going to tell you something about that movie and one of your posts, and I'd like to film you reacting to it.
Please, I know what post that is.
I actually love that film. I've watched it over and over again, and guess what, man? Guess what? Amazon actually refunded my money back.
You're like, you didn't mean to watch that, right? What are you doing?
Hey. They probably called the cops because they thought someone had a stroke hitting the button.
Anytime I get money now, it's like reparations. So when Amazon gave me that money back, I was like, hey, reparations, baby. Give it to me. I take it.
You should at least tell them what 8989 Redstone is, because there's, you know,
8989 Redstone is probably the greatest horror movie ever created. I love it.
Absolutely. I've heard that. Have you seen it, Bevan?
No.
Do you have did Amazon Prime not go into Florida because it's Florida, or do you have access to Amazon?
I have access to Amazon Prime. Prime thinks I'm in New York right now.
Did the armadillos eat the cables?
I haven't seen any of those things. I'm going to see.
You should watch 8989 Redstone if you dare.
I don't know if I dare right now.
Normally I tell people to watch it at night because it's scarier, but you're already in Florida, so it'll be really scary.
Brian, listen, man, I've thought about this. I mean, it could be an anthology series, man. The way you did it.
I told you, I'm going to end my career on Whitestone. It's going to be the first horror movie to ever take place on a bridge.
I love it.
Anyway, sorry, Rich.
I think we're
doing the plugs.
You're doing the plugs. 8989 Redstone. Get those numbers up on Amazon Prime.
But in the meantime, let's watch this trailer.
Billy Galaxy here at Billy Galaxy Vintage Toys and Collectibles in Portland, Oregon.
Hi there, we're from Cherry Bomb Toys.
We are co-owners of Farpoint Toys and Collectibles in Mays Landing, New Jersey.
Oh, we're married, by the way.
We've been married 18 years.
Our dream was to open up a vintage and modern toy store.
And we own Toy du Jour Vintage Toys Arts and Farts in Chicago, Illinois.
I've always been a collector, but when you sell, it's a completely different thing.
Yes!
Star Wars.
We're in Haarlem, the Netherlands.
So we're here doing favorite things in the store right now, countdown. I'm gonna start with number one.
He-Man got me into She-Ra, and a lot of girls I know, it's the other way around.
Coming in at number three.
Markers. Look at this!
Now, with the COVID epidemic here, has kind of put a screeching halt to business.
It honestly is one of the worst times that you could be selling stuff.
I know Billy is struggling to keep me employed.
My family is solely dependent on me.
Trying to get life back to as close to what we were previously as possible.
So we appreciate the fact that we do have an outlet to be able to sell our toys.
How have we survived? Are we surviving? How many times are we gonna have to cut our own children's hair?
Be safe, wash your hands.
Keep calm, buy toys.
Man, I'm leaking.
emotional.
Yeah. Now, how long, just so people have the details, when did it come out? How often does it come out?
The first one came out, I guess, about 3 weeks ago. The second one came out 3 weeks early by accident. We're still learning a couple things. And the next one, we maybe July 4th or 7th or something. We have some control over what happens, not total control. But we have two of them are out. The third one is locked. That's Joseph Hand from Lesher, England. So I think that one will probably come out before July 10th. We're trying to space them out. Ideally they come out every 2 or 3 weeks. But I actually think we'll be able to, we're catching up. The Japanese episodes take a long time to make because of the translations. So that's been slowing us down. Yeah.
We're making them as fast as possible.
Better said.
Yeah.
Now, I know about the three guys. I know they're all collectors. Are you a collector, Bevan?
A collector of toys? Well, yes. You know, being in New York City and having a small apartment, I have to make choices. Am I going to collect comic books, books, or toys? Now, if I had more room, I think I would collect more toys. But I think I have a couple of Funko Pops, which is Ming Chen and Mike Zapsik, and the Mystery Science Theater 3000 pops. And I think I have a Jyn Erso pop too. And that's, I have a Batman pop too, because I'm a big bat nerd. So yes, but I don't have what I'm looking at right now with Brian in the background. I don't have that. Don't have the room in New York City.
I'm just sending you a picture of my Batman shelf. I don't think you've ever seen my Batman shelf.
Oh man, like what? Well, I believe I hooked you up with some of those Batman toys, if I recall. At
No, we gave all of those to Netflix.
You did what?
Yeah.
You didn't save one for me?
No. More in particular, I didn't save one for me. By the way, I literally took a picture of the executive from Netflix holding them to send it to DC, not your friend. But somebody your friend introduced me to, uh-huh. You would have thought she'd given me like the codes to the nuclear missile silos. She's like, we really need those back. And I'm like, oh, the statue you made $250,000 of that I'm giving to Netflix and told you I'm giving to Netflix? Oh.
Ew.
Yeah. So I literally took a picture and sent her the picture. And it was
To be clear, she's not my friend.
It was not your friend. It was someone she introduced.
Oh, it's getting deep.
First off, hold on. I'm on my phone.
This is like Atlanta Housewives.
Wait.
Yeah.
First off, she's not my friend. I met her at New York Comic Con, and I don't know how we got talking about toys. Oh, I was looking at the Batman figurines, and I was like, yeah, no, my friend made the toys that made it. She's like, oh my God, I want to meet Brian. Can you introduce me to Brian, please? I work for DC.
And she was great. She was great. Good. Yeah, good. She could have been better. But who's ever in charge of like statue deployment? Not so great.
Wait, guys, I got to run and get my charger. My laptop's about to die.
Go do it.
All right. Sounds good.
Oh yeah, please hurry back. In the meantime,
in the meantime, here's some love for you.
Love. We definitely need that
We need all the love.
For sure. Bevan, you mentioned that it was emotional for you when you watched the trailer. Why do you think a show like this is important?
Well, I love the comic book community for obvious reasons. And like I said, I'm really good friends with Ming Chen and Mike Zapsik, and they run the Kevin Smith Secret Stash store. And they also run, I also podcast with them at A Shared Universe, which is their podcast studio in New Jersey. And I'm really connected to them, and I know that like this is their livelihood. And when we were all ordered to stay home, my heart went out to them because I know that they rely on people to actually physically show up in the podcast studio and in the store. And I know their families really well too. And I also know that they make a lot of their income from the Comic-Con community as well, like going to these cons, traveling to the cons, and stuff like that. So. Their store's not in the show, at least Brian, their store's not in the show, right?
Yeah, they didn't reach out. We made it like first come, first serve. But I mean, okay. I hate name. I know Kevin, and like I talked about it with Kevin, and they're doing okay.
Yeah, no, they're doing fine. I'm sorry, guys. I'm on my phone because the service in Florida sucks on the Wi-Fi.
What
mean? I know. It's me. It's all my fault, Brian. But I have to flip back and forth to see you, Brian, because you're on another panel, and then the rest of them are on like one nice little neat panel. But yeah, no, they're doing fine. They were very innovative. Like I said, they took their podcast studio and they made it all virtual as well. So they've been thankfully doing very well. But I do know that they were part of like the whole Diamond movement to help get, you know, people to buy comic books and Diamond toys again with Back the Comeback. And that was a very big thing that I got involved with. So that's why it was emotional.
What's the C stand for?
What's the what?
What's the C stand for? It says VCE.
I know, that's my middle initial.
What's your middle name?
You're Facebook friends with me, Brian, on Facebook. It shows it. You don't read my name.
It's my middle name.
Brian Volk-Weiss.
No, it's actually my last name. Bonner has an exclamation point. I like that.
Yeah, it's Shetty. It's French.
Shetty.
Right? I'll keep it.
My middle name is Antoine.
Antoine? I like
that's
that.
That's it? Nice.
My friends
call down the middle names.
What's your middle name, Robin?
Marie.
Ooh.
I love
way,
Marie.
By the way,
my middle name is Marie.
Oh, really?
Fun fact.
Dreads too.
Fun fact, Robin loves this story. My mom's nemesis my entire childhood was a guy she worked with named Robin Henry.
Nah.
So the first time I think I met Robin, I think that's one of the first things we talked about.
Yes, there's some karma in that. Something, some sort of cosmic irony that your mother's enemy and you and I. Something.
Brian, what is your middle name?
Spencer.
Oh, for hire.
Brian Spencer Volk-Weiss. That's a long name. It sounds very.
Brian Spencer for hire. That was my first job at Spencer Gifts. That was my first design job.
Ooh.
Spencer Gifts.
Huh. Yeah.
Nice.
I'll say it. I used to love Spencer Gifts.
Me too. There's always that corner I wasn't supposed to go in as a kid that I always try to sneak over to when my mom wasn't looking.
By the way, Spencer Gifts, very different these days. Yeah.
I know. They went full-blown smut.
Yeah.
I didn't even know it still existed. It still exists?
Bonner, it couldn't be said better than what he just said. I mean, it's borderline like a sex shop.
Yeah.
Really?
Full blown.
Yeah. Wow.
Before it was tongue in cheek, and that was like Benny Hill. You know, that was the fun of it. But now it's like smut.
Desperate times, man. It always sells. Sex always sells.
That's it.
That and liquor stores, right?
Yeah. That and liquor stores. So when are you making the sex that made us?
Yeah.
Now we're talking. Let's get into it. This is my kind of Comic Con panel.
daily. You should do the magazines. You should do the restaurants that went out of business. We get that every day. Dozens, if not hundreds, depending on time of year.
Where did the seed for the idea for the toy store, do you remember the first moment you came up with the idea?
Well, it's really funny. Yeah. I do remember it. And then I was talking to the guy who inspired me, and he forgot about it. But I was talking to Kyle from Black Cat Collectibles. I'm sure the name is different, but at least it has Black Cat in it. That's one thing I've noticed. There's always some degree of comics, collectibles, or vintage in all of these names. But so I'll just say Black Cat and Burbank. Anyway, we were talking in very early March about a possible quarantine. And I was like, what happens if there's a quarantine? And he was like, our income goes down by 80%, but our costs stay the same. And then as soon as I heard there was going to be a quarantine, I couldn't stop thinking about that. And then Sheila, my wife, was watching for the first and only time ever, by the way, some show in our bedroom about like a noodle maker in Japan. You would have loved it, Robin. With iPhones, all shot on iPhones. And I was like, and it looked great. And I was like, we could do that. We got all the And that's, I called Billy. Like it's literally like 7:01 a.m. the next day. And I was like, hey, if we gave you a list of to shoot, would you shoot it? And he did, and that was it. And then we asked 49 other stores to do it, and they said yes.
Brian texted me that video of the noodle maker, and he's like, no, you texted me, what was it? It was something else. It was a cooking show.
No, it was about a dude making fancy noodles.
Right, and you're like, watch this. This is the show we're going to make, but with toys.
I actually forgot about that.
Yeah. 11 at night, you're like, watch this.
And I just want to say, like, this show, not makeable without Rich. Oh. Rich, like, I figured out the original idea and everything and whatever with Billy, but, like, it would have ended there. The fact that it's a series, the fact that it resembles a professional enterprise, all Rich.
Thank you.
Rich is the hardest working man in pop culture. He does a lot for the fans.
That's for sure.
Need my cape. Thank you, Dave. That's very kind of you to say. But like when we were doing season three of Toys, when we did the premiere party, one of the most rewarding elements of the promotional lead up to that premiere was the premiere party that we had various stores around the country host. And we had well over 50 stores doing that around the country and even internationally too. And being able to reach out to those owners, a lot of them I knew, but a lot more I didn't know, and to talk to them and to hear the excitement about season three of Toys and how excited they were to see it and how excited they were to be a part of this promotional thing that we're doing, and like seeing how important the connection between, you know, this thing that they love to watch and the people making it, showing that appreciation to all of these stores, because these stores are not just retail, you know, outlets. They're hubs for the community. They're hubs for people who love toys and comics and collectibles and pop culture to like gather and talk about and, you know, make friends and whatnot. And that's that community element of it is what I think Brian and I are constantly trying to do with A Toy Store Near You, is like show this community in action and show like how it comes together when, you know, times are tough, and with all of these stores kind of like pulling for each other and pulling together. That's the most beautiful thing for me, is like to see this all actually, you know, happening in front of us.
That's and was cool, the man. Was the biggest challenge then just technology, because the people wanted to do it.
Oh, it wasn't. I mean again, I'm not just saying this like to, you know, be, you know, show a good face or something. I mean, no. Everything worked every single time. There was not a single technical hiccup. I mean, I'm not gonna do my usual joke, even though it's based on a true story. The only person who f***ed up was me. Like, literally, every store, our entire post department, our entire distribution department. Rich, did we have a single hiccup that lasted more than 2 hours?
No, and I mean, anything that happened was just, you know, it's a learning experience. I mean, these people who run these stores, they're not DPs or audio mixers or not whatnot, but they
are. But that's my whole point. Yeah. They're not, but we still didn't have a problem.
We still did it.
We got stuff from Japan, England, Holland. We're getting stuff from Mexico City next week. Like, it's not one hiccup. Anything that could really be a hiccup was... didn't happen. Not one.
That's congratulations. Yeah, that's unheard of.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not us. It's the stores.
Yeah.
And also, I have to give credit to a company that drives me insane 99% of the year. I mean, the iPhone is amazing. I mean, it's amazing. It was, and I never know if this is interesting or if I'm in the weeds. The data that the phones shoot is small enough to send to us easily, like in Dropbox. But it's thick enough that our big color correcting machines and our audio correcting machines can treat it as though we'd shot it with a $500,000 camera. Like, that's what was bonkers.
Right. That's the new era. You know, that's the new dawn, you know, and kids are going to be using this, you know, and they're already using it.
You know?
So, I mean, that is cool. And also too, the cool part too is that you allow them to be a part of the process. Mm-hmm. So when you're personally invested in the process, you're going to have that little extra care. You're going to have some thought to expand on the idea. you know, and right now, who's to say no? You know, let's take that idea and run with it. And that is so cool to be collaborative like that and open to collaboration.
Yeah, and to see all the little creative bits from each different owner flourish in the episode.
Oh, yeah.
They're not the same people, but everyone's personality comes out in really cool ways.
The other thing
what have the fans said? I mean, has there been a lot of feedback from people watching it? And
the first episode was like 96% positive, 4% think, and I'll take responsibility for this, that I focus too much on COVID. Like, they're like, hey, it's already depressing enough out there. Like, I want to just see a show about toys. So the second episode is like 99.9% positive. And in my defense, that episode locked before the first one did, premiered. So, but the third one also had locked, but the fourth and beyond, we are, I wouldn't say minimizing COVID, but maximizing toys a bit more and making it a little bit lighter. But it's one of the cool things about a show, and obviously we didn't do this on purpose, so maybe I'm rationalizing, but one of the cool things about putting out a series really slowly is that shit happens that you can incorporate. So Farpoint Toys had a fire. They literally, like, the whole store almost burnt down.
No.
One of the owners almost got electrocuted. Well, because the six episodes before that were moving slowly, we can now incorporate that into their episode.
Wow.
So that's, if there's any benefit to releasing 10 episodes over 19 months, that would be it.
They're in my hometown.
That's a joke. It's not 19 months.
Fair points in my hometown area, so it's cool that they get that bit of shine. You know, we kind of went to the mutual comic book shop back in the day called Beachcomber Coin Shop. Like, that was our only comic book shop, toy store in the area at that time. So it's cool that they finally get their little just.
By the way, Vonner, you reminded me. I'm gonna get you that R2. I mean, I am going to get you that R2. The next time I see one.
You're going to make me cry.
I'm going to make you cry where once went wrong. Believe me.
Thank you so much.
It's on a very special episode of almost the exact same people, minus the awesome Bevan, it was revealed that somebody broke into Vonner's childhood home and stole his, amongst other things, I'm sure, like jewelry.
Yeah.
Cash. The remote-controlled R2-D2, and I am on a mission.
Wait, was Vonner the one in the story that you told us when you came on the podcast about Star Wars?
I apologize.
That was different. Skywalker.
3 weeks ago. Yeah.
Yeah, never mind. I'm kidding. Carry on. Carry on. I'm kidding. I'm joking. What,
wasn't there, there's also an altruistic aspect to a toy store near you, right?
Yes. I'm doing like the world's worst job ever. Explain.
Okay. I thought there was, but I want to be sure.
Well, if anybody's wondering why are we releasing it this way, the answer is we want to get the episodes out as quickly as possible while the stores are struggling in an effort to get them money and publicity, and hopefully that publicity. And we know for a fact it's helped a little bit with Billy and with 1313 Mockingbird. They both told me their sales have gone up a little bit online. So I hope it goes up more, but like almost all the money from the show, and if I had to guess, it'll be all of it, is gonna be going back to the stores.
Good.
That's
awesome. That's so sweet.
I mean, that's one of the best parts, I think. You know,
probably. You'd think I would shine a spotlight on that instead of talking about the Tiger King. But we are doing that.
Well, I can imagine the fans and the store owners, and David, you could probably speak to this. I'm sure that really means a lot.
Yeah, it does. You know, because I think, you know, comic book shops, you know, I think they feel independently lonely, you know, like they're in this fight by themselves, you know. So I think once these guys actually see how many people, you know, circle the wagons, you know, kind of the community has to take care of its own now, you know? And I think like that's the cool part, you know? Like these big companies have benefited off these little guys for a long, long time. And a lot of them have gone away, like the Suncoast and all that stuff. And so now that these smaller mom and pops are around, mm-hmm. like let's redirect the energy and let's take care of them for a change, you yeah. know? Because we're all fueling each other's childhood passions and creativities mm. and everything like that. And those are our first experiences, our first memories, our first, you know, we'll never forget those as long as we live. And I think that's why we're always on this eternal quest, like pop culture, whatever era that you're talking about, there's always this need to, you know, express it, you know, express the past and turn it on its ear a little bit. So, you know, this is, it's important. It's important. So it's good that, you know, that we're all giving back.
Yeah. Especially during this time. And yeah. I know, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just agreeing.
Oh, and I know this is not all that Nacelle, I mean, 56 episodes for Rit, 50 episodes, is it?
50 episodes.
50 episodes. But I do know that it's probably not all that Nacelle is doing, although 50 episodes is a lot.
It is
a lot. I assume there are other shows that I know about or don't know about. But is it? Do the toy shows continue after the 50? Do they not continue? Is it a 50 and out, or do you know yet? Do you?
I mean, I don't think there would be anything wrong with making more, as you know, if the show, it seems like it's successful, but we only have two out. Why would we stop if people want to see it? Yeah.
Okay. I mean,
so you got a full-time job, Rich.
I mean, I'm pretty sure they made like 400 episodes of Dinos, Drive-Ins, and Dives. So there's no reason yeah. 400 episodes of A Toy Store Near You. Nothing against Guy Fieri, but
yeah. Yeah, nothing against a guy. I haven't watched all 400, but yeah.
at the rate we're putting the episodes out, combined with the rate of crises now increasing, there'll probably be a whole new crisis to deal with in 2022. So yeah. Put that in the show.
Yeah, still more toy stores. Still set yet more. So what other projects is Nacelle working on besides the
your favorite show is coming out early July. We got a show with Zac Efron, very buyer. This is coming out late July, right, Rich?
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry, the Zac. I don't want to even say the date. I'm still scared. But early July, our Zac Efron show called Down to Earth with Zac Efron. That's coming out, which is all about the environment and food. So yep, that's coming out. We've been working on that for about 16 years. what else? We just had All the Way Black on BET Plus come out, which you also worked on. We're working on a show with Disney Plus called Behind the Attraction.
Brian, there's another project I feel like we should give a shout to that someone near and dear to our hearts, and that is Margaret Lush.
Yes,
for sure. Now there's a project, Nacelle's doing a project on Margaret, is this correct?
Feature-length documentary.
Woo! Feature-length documentary. And for those who don't know who Margaret is, Rich, do you want to tell them who she is and how we first came, like how I first came to know her is through the Toys series, but.
Margaret is a visionary exec who is responsible for so much of your childhood. She's a pioneer, and it's because of her that we have things like Mighty Morphin Power Rangers and Batman the Animated Series and X-Men and a slew of others that we don't even have time to talk about. But her story is outstanding, and she's just an amazing person, and I can't speak highly enough of her. She's yeah, this is something you guys are gonna watch.
And where did the idea for the doc come from?
It's funny, I was standing right next to you when it happened. Basically, I have to admit, I'm embarrassed about this. I'd never heard of her in my life. And when we did the interview with her, I was like, she's full of there's no way this woman did all this stuff and I've never heard of her. And then when I realized she wasn't full of I was like, this is a crime. Like, this is horrific that somebody like this is, like, there are people with 1% of her accomplishments that are talking at panels making 20,000 bucks a pop. So for someone like her who did what she did, like, and again, similar to Toy Store Near You, it was like, we got cameras, we got money, why don't we do it? So, I mean, that's, yeah, we just did it.
Is this still like a couple of years out? So fans honestly, are not gonna be clamoring?
It's so funny. Without COVID, we would have been locked by the end of the year and it would have come out in January or February. I mean, our colleague, as you know, Brian Stillman, I mean, he was a machine. I mean, he was literally flying all over the country again and again and again and again. By the way, even after COVID was like known to be here and killing people, Brian was still, for the record, Robin, I did tell him to stop, but he didn't listen. But yeah, I mean, he really, anyway. So we probably have 40% of the movie shot.
Okay.
And then once COVID starts winding down and my guess is now because of COVID, we're 3 or 4 months behind schedule at a minimum.
So we can expect it maybe in the next year or so. That's still soon.
Yeah, it'll definitely be next year.
We have some great interviews in that doc too. I don't want to spoil anything, but every time Brian would land a new one, he would text me and be like, I've got blah, blah, blah. And it's each one was just like, oh my God, that's amazing. So yeah,
That's going to be exciting. Yeah. And she's a wonderful interview herself. I mean, she's fascinating. She's so interesting and very open.
What I always say about her, and I tell her this all the time, forgetting about pop culture, she should write like Margaret Lesh's Book of Wisdom.
Mm. Yeah, she's very good.
She's so wise.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome.
She's touched so many things and you know, that you don't even realize. And she brings it up as if, you know, it's like, oh yeah, I was on that. And you're like, what? Like, what are you talking
about? We were at her house shooting the first interview of the whole movie. Like, she would have stuff on the walls. Of course, I don't remember, but I'm like, oh, why do you have this? And she'd be like, oh, well, I greenlit that. And I'm like, you did? Like, I mean, it was like, oh. And Brian would be like, yeah, no, I didn't know either. I mean, it was like at least 3 times in her house, stuff on the walls. Like, massive stuff.
I think the moment when she said to us, oh, I was Stan Lee's boss. Remember at that one moment that we were, you know, you're going, you know, do you know Stan Lee? Oh, yeah, I was his boss. And you're just like, what?
You're like,
oh, yeah, you're just like blown away by that.
She also said something, and I don't know if you were there for this or not, that really affected me and how I'm raising my children. Because I asked her, I think you were there. It was in the interview with that big red couch. She was like, I said to her, I go, you're that woman in the picture with 99 dudes. Like all throughout your career up until the last end. So I'm like, why you? Why were you able to, like, why was it always you? And what she said, which to me went across, was completely against everything I'd ever heard, was, if you remember, she said her father was in the military, mm-hmm. and she kept getting pulled out of schools mm-hmm. and put into new schools. And every time she'd have to quickly make new friends and build a network. So literally, without any exaggeration, next year, my daughter is going into her third school. I'm not doing it on purpose because of what Margaret said, but what Margaret said gave me the confidence to not leave her in a school at all costs. Mm. Like, I knew it would be good for her to go to a different school and that could help her. Whereas I think a lot of people are like, oh, just kids need stability.
Right.
Yeah. So when I talk about her wisdom, that's an example.
Yeah, wow. she's pretty incredible. She really is.
Oh, season 2 of All the Way Black comes out in November. More spook.
Season 2.
Yeah, now we've got the first. What was season 1 is now seasons 1 and 2.
What we're going to do right here is go black into time. All the Way Black. The only place you can get 70s, 80s, and 90s trivia.
Let's take a journey as we skip down memory lane and run a Boston on all you jokers.
Rule number 1 with spades, no reneging.
With the right partner, I'll tax that ass. Bye, y'all. Come on.
I wanted this haircut. The Bobby Brown, the Gumby, that was big for me.
Man, what the hell? Man, you got me looking like Gumby.
They sell everything in the barbershop. A dude was selling cell phones already cut on.
How did I go get it, guys?
I didn't go get it, because I would go get it, baby.
Yeah, we were nasties.
Here, you're going to learn so much. We're going to laugh, we're going to joke, you might cry a little bit, you might pee a little bit, I don't know. But you're going to have a good time here on this show.
Can't wait.
It'll be awesome.
And you, that's on BET Plus. Right now.
It's so funny. It's so funny.
Episodes right now.
Watching that clip, you know, watching the barbershop thing, it's so funny because, like, in high school, at my barbershop, we had a guy there named Mubashir, and he used to sell everything. Like, literally, like, people got their school clothes from there, they got their sneakers from there, and he always had matching sets. So he had, like, the short set with the vest and the hat, you know. So back in the day, in 89, 90, you were hot, you know, you went to the barbershop and got your gear. Mubashir, you know, rest in peace. That was the man.
And are they putting them out weekly on BET Plus?
They dropped the first 6 on June 4th.
Okay.
They're going to drop the second 6 in October, in November.
So you can stream 6 right now if you have BET
Plus. Right now.
Nice.
Oh, that's awesome. That's a fun thing. And are you guys also talking about the grant? Is grant already out?
Grant came out Memorial Day weekend, all about President Grant. There he is. My favorite thing, by the way, and this happens almost daily, literally happened last night. I'll get texts from people being like, hey, you got to see this Grant thing on History Channel. And I'm like, you need to look at the credits more carefully. But yeah, that's out, and people seem to like it.
See, and Brian, in spades, that's called throwing down the big joker.
Ooh. Okay.
The big joker.
You throw the big joker down when you do that.
Okay. I like, that's my new expression.
Throwing down the joker.
Use it in every conversation now.
Well, it sounds like the cell's got a big stew of stuff now, because it is like a lot of different things. I mean, the grant is very different than toys. It is very different. I mean, style-wise, I'm saying. But in the history nostalgia vein, is that?
I can only sell what I'm excited about.
Right.
As you know, Robin, one time I sold something I wasn't excited about, and it sucked for everybody, especially the audience. So... and also all the executives who greenlit it. So, yeah. So what may seem eclectic, what'd you say?
I didn't say anything. I just laughed.
No. Vonner's asking a dangerous question.
What was it?
No.
I don't know if he wants to go there.
I'll text it to you.
Yeah. That's probably something for later.
Next time we're in Hall H.
Yes.
I'll admit it publicly. But anyway. Yeah. Yeah, so, I mean, what might seem eclectic to the world, if you look around my office, is not eclectic. I mean, there's a grant shelf, you know? Mm-hmm. Like I said, I only can sell what I'm passionate about. Or I only try to sell what I'm passionate about.
And luckily for Rich and all of us, you're passionate about pop culture, or else Rich probably wouldn't survive.
That is not Rich. Rich was doing great before he met me. He'll be doing great. I got hit by a bus today.
No, I meant in the sense that even as a consumer of what you do, I mean, he loves, you know, this.
I mean,
this is
what I said. Like, I mean, obviously, I put 150% into everything that I've done the entire time that I've been in this career. But there is a nice little added spark when there's something that you're so passionate about that you can pour into everything else that you pour into your job. So yeah, it just makes getting up in the morning just a little easier.
And I would think that's the same for all of you in this genre, in this world, you know, mm-hmm. that's what makes it worthwhile. Yeah,
it makes oh, yeah. you stay up a little bit later, you know, it makes you get up a little bit earlier, you know, it makes things kind of shed off you that normally at a normal job, it would stay with you, you know, mm-hmm. you kind of like, you know, and I mean, I'm sure like Rich would know, like, if you're in a crunch, sometimes you have to communicate the way you have to communicate and just to get it done. And in normal environments, some people may hold on to those, you know, how they're spoken to or just the nature of that feeling of being swamped and you got to really go, 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 go. But, you know, in this, since you love it so much, it's like you expect the whirlwind. You welcome the whirlwind because this is what you prepared for. You know, now it's like putting everything that you prepare for into motion.
Yeah, it makes the hard days not as hard and the good days even better. So,
I remember that, Rich.
You're saying it already.
Where's that?
Of course, you also bring a knowledge to it. When just you know, a knowledge and a passion to it already. That is a for all of you. I mean, that's a big part of it. You know, when you're doing that to the table.
Yeah, when you're doing what you love, it's not a job, it's play.
Yeah.
Well, that's as good a note as any to wrap
yeah,
this thing up.
That's
right?
For sure. That's for sure. May everybody get to do what they love. That's for sure. Yeah.
Amen. Well, thank you guys so much. Thank you.
Of course, thank you for having
me. Thank all of you.
Thank you.
Congratulations, everyone.
Appreciate it.